Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Are you happy to be in God's presence? Are you?
Yes.
Amen. I am as well. Are you ready to hear from Him?
Yes.
I am as well. Amen. Shall we pray? Father, we just want to thank you. What a privilege you have given us to see the light of another day and to be called your daughters and your sons, your children. And that we can gather together because of Jesus to sit and learn at your feet. We ask, O God, that you speak unto us your word of life. You still speak. You spoke in the past. You're still speaking to your children today. So your sheep will hear your voice. Lord, today let us hear your voice. Amen. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Let your word profit us. Amen. We give you praise. Amen. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen. Shall we stand up for the reading of God's word? Deuteronomy chapter 30, verses 11 to 20. Deuteronomy chapter 30, we read from verse 11 to 20. For this commandment which I command you today is not too mysterious for you, nor is it far off. It is not in heaven that you should say, who will ascend into heaven and bring it unto us, that we may hear it and do it. Nor is it beyond the sea that you should say, who will go over the sea for us and bring it to us, that we may hear it and do it. But the word is very near you, in your mouth and in your heart, that you may do it. See, I have set before you today life and good, death and evil. In that I command you today to love the Lord your God, to walk in his ways, and to keep his commandments, his statutes, and his judgments, that you may live and multiply, and the Lord your God will bless you in the land which you go to possess. But if your heart turns away so that you do not care, and are drawn away, and worship other gods and serve them, I announce to you today that you shall surely perish. You shall not prolong your days in the land which you cross over the Jordan to go in and possess. Verse 19. I call heaven and earth as witnesses today against you, that I have set before you life and death, blessing and cursing. Therefore choose life, that both you and your descendants may live, that you may love the Lord your God, that you may obey his voice, and that you may cling to him. For he is your life and the length of your days, and that you may dwell in the land which the Lord swore to your fathers, to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, to give them. May the Lord bless the reading of his holy words. Let's take our seats in God's presence. Today we'll be looking at what I have titled, Choose Life. Choose Life. We saw in the passage that we read, I love the way that passage started. You know, God was saying to the Israelites in verse 11, he said, for this commandment which I command you today is not too mysterious for you. That means that it's not far-fetched. It's not something that we cannot understand. The Bible says the commandments of God are not burdensome. God is our Father. He does not put burdens on us. Amen. He wants to make our lives better. So his commandments are to make our lives better. So he said those commandments, they are not mysterious. And they are not far away from you. They are not in heaven. that you should say, how can we get to heaven to get those words, that we may hear them and do them? He said, they are not beyond the sea. So we've got the Thames River there. We don't have to cross the sea to go and hear the word of God. Amen. He said that we should say, who will go over the sea for us and bring it to us, that we may hear it and do it? But where is the word? Verse 14. But the word is near you. And that's the word that God is speaking to us today. The word is near us, in our mouth and in our hearts, that we may do it. So God has given us his word. It's in our mouth, it's in our hearts. Amen. As we study the word of God and we lay them up in our hearts, the Bible says, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. So when we store up God's word in our hearts, before long, we will begin to speak God's word. And not just speak it, we will also begin to do it. Because God is not interested in people who just profess his name and his words, but he is interested in people who actually live by his word. Amen. So today we're looking at the title, Choose Life. I am very particular about our choices. You know, I felt that this is a principle that we need to get right. And this cuts across every one of us, because on a daily basis we make choices. As children, we make choices. What do I want to do when I go to university? It's a choice our teenagers and those doing GCSE, they have to make. And what are the things that must guide your choice? We have to look at that today. As husbands and wives, we make choices. You know, as parents, we make choices over our children. As professionals, we make choices. So every day, we make choices. So we're going to look at what God is saying about our choices. Our memory verse, we can just pull that up. It's Proverbs 14 verse 12. It says, there is a way that seems right to a man, but its end is the way of death. So in our choice making, it is not enough to look at it with physical eyes and say, this looks right, this feels right, you know, this looks perfect, because it might not be God's choice for us. We have to come to a level where our choices are God's choices. We should not just go by what we feel or what we want, but what does God want? What is God saying about this situation? We must begin to look at situations with the eyes of God. Look at it in his perspective so that we can walk in the will of God. Your choices. Why are we so particular about choices? Why is God particular about choices we make? Your choices determines your destination. Look at us today. We are all product of our choices. The person that we chose to marry, or God gave us to marry, amen, we are stuck with them for life. Amen. We've got children, amen. So we are all here today as a result of the choices that we made many years ago. And where we will be tomorrow will be based on decisions that we make today. So our choices determine our destinations. It determines our outcomes. Whether we turn out poor and wretched and destroyed, or whether we turn out, you know, well and God's showcase. Amen. Amen. Children, this is also for you, so make sure you listen to me and listen well. Amen. Our choices determines between life and death. So a young man or a young girl who chooses to go into drugs, I see them all the day and my heart cries out for something. Who chooses to go into drugs has already determined what is going to end up like. Isn't it? Amen. A wretched, a poor man, a diseased man, somebody whose life will be cut short soon because of the choice that he made to go into drugs. So your choices determine between life and death. What choices are you making? What choices have you made in the past? We must own up. You know, many of us have made wrong choices in the past. And maybe in the future we'll even make wrong choices. We thank God for his mercy. But it's important that we learn this principle so that we can begin to change our choices or let our choices be based on God's will. Amen.
Amen.
So it is crucial that we get our choices right. So choices. The very first thing I want to say is that on a daily basis, we make choices. The choice of what to wear. And what determines the choices we make? You know, some people, what to wear is who? What's going to kill? You know what I mean? What's going to impress somebody? You know, the Holy Spirit can guide what we wear. It's not about what we wear. Our beauty is not about what we wear. It's more than that. Our beauty is the inner beauty. God in us. God, today we're talking about the mind of Christ. That's the beauty. It's good to look good. Amen.
Amen.
It's good to look good. So you must look good, especially when we come to church. If everywhere you go, you look good. Try your best to look good. But don't get into debt because you want to look good. Amen. So if my motives for what I am wearing is wrong, then that is not acceptable. Amen. I have become smelly. Hallelujah. Because my motives are wrong. So in determining what I want to wear, what is going to glorify God? Holy Spirit, what do you want me to wear? So that's one of the things, one of the choices we make on a daily basis. What should I wear? What should I buy? Some of us, especially ladies, we go out with a list of just to buy a couple of things, and we come back with 1,001 things. I own up, I've done that. I'll just pick a basket, just a couple of things. Before I knew it, oh, the children will like it. So, you know, but we have to be careful because we have to be responsible for the resources that God gives us. How do we use our resources that God has given us? Our resources of time. God has given us 24 hours in a day. How do you make use of your 24 hours? For some of our children, they love to play games. They love to watch TV. They love to play Xbox. Is that a way to spend our time? It's good. I love you to do that. But God will hold us account for the way we spend our time. As husbands and wives, how do we spend our time? Do we spend our time together? Or does everybody do their own thing? Amen. So how do we manage our time? Do we spend quality time in prayer and in the Word on a daily basis? One thing I have learned in life in a few years I have known God and I'm still knowing God is that when you spend quality time with the Lord and you speak to the Lord and you love the Lord, your day becomes beautiful because God will direct your steps. He will give you ideas. He will give you words to say. In fact, I have a testimony. I did a research not long ago. And a few weeks ago, I felt, what have I gotten myself into? Why am I doing this master's when I don't even need it? I felt like I was a two-no. But I submitted the project. I just sent it to my supervisor. And because I felt overwhelmed and I felt, I've just had enough. I just want to get out of this thing now. So I sent it to her and then she said to me, I'm very sorry, I'm going to be blunt with you. You have to do this again. You need to ask for some more weeks and do it again. And I was broken. I was like, no, please. Anyway, I went to the Lord and I said, God, please help me. Because I can't really do anything without you. You know that. You just need to give me a structure for this work. So I sat down, asked for a few more weeks, and did the job. By the time I finished the job, I knew that the Lord has helped me. Because I wouldn't have produced that without God. A few days ago, I got the results back. I got 70% of the mark. Praise God for that. And I was told this can even be published, you know, with a little bit of amendments. So what am I saying? I'm saying that when we involve God in our choice making, in everything we do on a daily basis, He helps us. Even as you prepare for your GCSE, it's not going to be by your power. It's not going to be by your might. But the God will help you. Amen.
Amen.
So trust in His strength. So how do we manage our time? As we prepare for GCSEs, let's make sure we are studying hard. I'm praying and trusting God because the Holy Ghost has the originals. Amen.
Amen.
And He can reveal them to you. What about our money? How do we spend our money? I've been guilty of this in the past. Sometimes I feel that I'm too hoo-hoo-hoo. You know, you just give and give and give. Well, we need to let the Holy Spirit lead us as we give so that we're not wasting God's money. We need to invest the money that God gives us
few days ago, my brother was saying to me, are you thinking about this? Are you thinking about that? Are you thinking about that? You know, he said, because when you're thinking about it, then you begin to put some money aside for it. Let's not blow the money God has given us. It's not just for us, but it's for generations to come. And it's for all those around us. Are we using the money God has given us to bless others? That's what we need to do. What about our gifts? The gifts God has given you. How are you choosing to use it? Are you using it to glorify God? Or are you using it to glorify yourself? Are you using it to serve God? Or are you keeping it or hiding it? You know, we can choose between success and failure. And a good example that came to mind was Joshua and Caleb, the 12 spies. They were faced with the same circumstances. They all went to spy the land. And 10 came back and said, wow, those people were giants. And 22 said, no, what God has said is what we choose to believe. And we stand by that. They are meat for us. Amen. So it's your choice. Your life is your choice. Many a times we blame others. We blame others for our misery. Why I'm like this because of you. Because you are like this, you are like that. No, we should stop blaming others. We should take responsibility for our lives. Amen. So we can choose between success and failure. We can choose between sorrow and joy. What did God ask us to choose? He said, choose life. So God has given us the power to make a choice. Amen. We can choose to be joyful. Habakkuk 3, I love that scripture, verse 17. He said, even though the fig tree may not blossom, and there may not be fruit in the vine, and the labor of olive may fail, he said, yes, I will rejoice. I choose to be joyful. Now, listen, joy is different from happiness. There will be some times that we're not happy because of circumstances. I may not be happy because I'm in pain. I may not be happy because I don't have money. I may not be happy because of things around me. But joy does not depend on the happenings. Amen. Our happiness depends on happenings. But the joy that we got from Christ does not depend on what is going on around us. Even if there is no fruit, I still have joy. Nothing can take away my joy from me. Amen. So choose joy. Tell somebody, choose joy. Let me see you smile. Smile from your heart. Choose joy. Sometimes I feel that our children are faced with lots of challenges. You know, their hormones are rushing, peer pressure. Choose the life of God. Last week, Pastor preached about be the hard one out. Choose to stand up for God. Don't feel shy. Don't feel like, they will think I'm religious. No. Amen. We can choose between bitterness and forgiveness. You can choose to forgive. You can choose to forgive others, irrespective of what they have done for you. That was what God did for us. He chose to forgive us. The very people who nailed him to the cross and spat on him and mocked him, King of the Jews, you cannot even save yourself. He chose to forgive them. Choose forgiveness. Amen. Even Stephen, while they were stoning him, said, Father, forgive them because they don't know what they're doing. You know, when people upset you, just think that they don't know what they're doing. Otherwise, they wouldn't have done that to you. Amen. Find an excuse to explain it away. Amen. You can choose to serve God or not. Or it's profitable when we serve God. You can choose to speak out or keep quiet. When you see that things are not done right, don't keep quiet. Speak out. You may lose friends. Speak out. Say no. You don't even need to speak the Bible. You don't even need to say this is what the Bible says. Just tell them the mind of God. Full stop. You can choose to let go of the pain of the past. For many people, the pain of the past, what somebody did to them many years ago, is keeping them down. You need to let that go, that pain go. Amen. Amen. Don't hold on to it. So it's your choice. Your choice could either make you or mar you. So it's important that you choose right. God gave us a willpower. Let's talk about willpower quickly. When God made man, he gave us a gift, and that gift is free will. The will to choose what you want to do with your life. Amen.
Amen.
I love God. You know, people who don't believe God will say, why did he give us the free will to choose between right and wrong? Anyway, she just has made us to do what is right. No, because God is a loving Father. He does not force his will on us. Amen. We're not robots. We're living beings, human beings made in his image. So we can reason. We can think. God gave us the ability to choose between life and death. So he said to the people of Israel, I have put before you life, death, evil, good, blessing, cursing. You choose which one you want to. God is a God of love who will never force his will on us. So he gives us the information we need so that we can make right choices. In medicine, we call it informed consent. Informed decision. Before you can make a decision or make a choice, you need an information to guide the choices that you make. So your information must be right. I want us to look at the choice that Adam and Eve made. They made a choice on that particular day. The Bible says in the Garden of Eden, every evening God will come down and commune with them. What a sweet fellowship. Having to speak to God face to face. But one day, the enemy tempted them and they yielded to the voice of stranger. So the choice of Adam and Eve left us with a legacy of sin, of death, of judgment, of bondage. Amen. So the choices that me and you make today will affect our children. It will affect our grandchildren. That's why God said to them, he said, choose life that it may be well with you and your descendants. Your choices is not just for you. Your choices will determine what legacy you leave behind. And that's why it's important to get it right. It may not always be convenient. You know, I think to Eve, it was the easiest option. Oh, okay, this looks good. So what are the factors that Adam and Eve based their decision on? What factors? Why did they fall? God had already commanded them, don't eat this fruit. Why did they do it? 1 John chapter 2 verses 15 to 17 gave us the answer. Can I have that on the screen, please? 1 John chapter 2, 15 to 17. Let's quickly read that. He said, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. Can we go to the next verse? For all that is in the world. Now, let's begin to list. The lust of the flesh. So the lust of the flesh is what my body wants. My body wants to eat all the time, you know, especially when I'm stressed. When I'm at work and, work is so busy, and you see some biscuits around, your body just wants you to keep your eating. Amen. That is the lust of the flesh. The lust of the flesh is what will make a man who is not married or a woman who is not married to sleep with somebody else. That's the lust of the flesh, immorality. So the lust of the flesh can lead us to make a wrong decision. Amen. He said the lust of the eyes. What I see, wow, he looks good, amen. It looks good, it feels good, but it may not be God's choice, amen. And the pride of life, your status, your position, how highly you place yourself, you know, those things are the love of the world, and they must not determine our choices. Are you getting something? So Adam and Eve, they left us a legacy of sin, of bondage, of judgments, of death, because of their wrong choices. The Bible says Eve saw that the fruit was good to behold, and it was a fruit to be desired, and she fell for it, and her husband fell for it. Can you see how many generations they destroyed? Because of one choice that they made? What about Jesus? Hallelujah. Thank God for Jesus. Who took away the legacy of death and judgment? Amen. Jesus had a choice to make. it was his choice to lay down his life. Can I just say that, you know, the choices, when we go by God's choices, it may not always be easy. It may not always be convenient. It may not feel like that's really what you want to do. Look at Jesus when he was dying. He said, Father, if it is possible, let this come. The pain was too much. The agony was just cannot be measured. But he said, nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done. So Jesus made a choice. He made a choice to die for us and lay down his very life for us. So sometimes your choices might mean you sacrificing something that is very precious to you. Amen.
Amen.
Jesus' choice brought us power over sin, brought us freedom and life through eternity. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So the bondage, the judgments, the eternal death that we inherited from Adam, Jesus came and set us free and gave us life forevermore. May his name be praised forever.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. So, not your will. Jesus said, not my will, but your will be done. Not your choice, but God's choice. Now, you may ask me, how do I know God's choice? Amen. I'll answer that question for you in a minute. Today is the Remembrance Day. We remember those who lost their lives in the World War. But those people paid a price. They paid with their lives. Amen. So, what price are you paying? What sacrifice are you laying down? Many of these men sacrificed their lives, and women, in the World War, so that we can have peace today. So what should influence or determine the choices we make? Our choices must be informed by the Word of God and guided by the Holy Spirit. In John 15, Jesus said, if you abide in me, and my word abide in you, then you will be fruitful. So in order to enjoy the blessing of God, we need to check the choice we make on a daily basis. Does this align with the will of God? Does it align with the word of God? Does it contradict the word of God? Is it because of my feelings, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the pride of life that I am making this decision? Is it going to bless people around me? Do you know, let me shock you, or you may already know, that your life is not just about you. It's not enough for you to just live and walk the face of this earth and be blessed. God wants you to be a blessing. That's your purpose. That everyone that you come in contact with, you bless them. Like we were saying this morning, it may not necessarily be in cash or in gifts, but it may just be a little kindness. It may be a little word of prayer that you say to somebody in trouble. Amen. They go a long way. So our choices must be informed by the word of God and must be guided by the Holy Spirit. In Isaiah chapter 30 verse 21, it said, you will hear a voice behind you saying, this is the way, walk in it. So the Holy Spirit still speaks today. So when we want to make decisions, who should I marry? Let me just on a lighter note. You know, when we were going to get married, me and Pastor, we went, we were friends and started courtship for about 5 years. And one day it upset me. And I went to God and I said, I'm not going to marry him. No, I am not marrying him. And I really meant it. I think I said it first time. There was a time I said it first time. I said it second time. And the third time I said to God, this is the straw that broke the camel's back. I am not going to marry him. I was adamant. And you know what happened? I went to bed. And as I went to bed, God speaks to me through dreams and visions. As I went to bed, I dreamt. That night, and in that dream, I saw two houses. And I saw a very beautiful house. And I said, oh yeah, I love this. This is good. Lust of the eyes. Pride of life. I said, this is good. I really love this. And then I saw one that didn't really look good. I said, I don't really want that. That's not good. Don't judge a book by its cover. And then, all of a sudden, the There was wind and storms like tornado. And before I knew it, my beautiful house had fallen. And I woke up, and I was panting. I was like, I didn't need a prophet to interpret that dream. I knew God was rebuking me, saying, hey, your choice or my choice? Which one do you want to settle for? Amen. Straight away, I said, oh, Lord, your will is what I want. Amen. Because if you marry the wrong person, you might even die before your time. You know, things can just go wrong. Somebody might look handsome today, tomorrow they might, something else might happen to them. They might be rich today, tomorrow they might be poisoned. But the God who knows the end from the beginning must be the one guiding your choice. Amen.
Amen.
So our choices must be informed, not only by the Word of God. The Word of God is His will, but by the Holy Spirit, who is with us, who is residing in us, who speaks to us if we care to listen. Let's look at Luke chapter 6, and I'll round up with that. Luke chapter 6, we read verses 46 to 49. Making the right choices. Choose life. Luke chapter 6, 46 to 49. But why do you call me Lord, Lord, and not do the things which I say? This is Jesus talking here. Whoever comes to me and hears my word, my sayings, and does them, I will show you whom he is like. He is like a man building a house. He dug deep. He laid the foundation on the rock. And when the flood arose, the stream beat vehemently against that house and could not shake it, for it was founded on the rock. What is God saying? Every time you hear His word, and you walk by His word, and you live by His word, what are you doing? You're building a foundation. You're building a foundation that your children will enjoy many years to come. Amen.
Amen.
Look at verse 49. For he who heard and did nothing is like a man who built a house on the earth without a foundation, against which the stream beat vehemently, and immediately it fell, and the ruin of that house was great. Do you know that this is similar to, I just went many years after, I remembered Matthew 7. But when I had that vision that God showed me, I didn't even remember the scripture. It was many years after that I said, hold on, that vision is actually in the scripture. You know, so when you hear the word of God, when you live by the word of God, come rain, come sun, you're laying a good foundation. Your life, there's no way your life will not turn out right. That's why God said in that Deuteronomy, let's go back to that Deuteronomy chapter 30. Deuteronomy chapter 30. And I read from verse 19. It said, I call heaven and earth as witnesses today against you, that I have set before you life and death, blessing and cursing. Therefore, choose life. I see God pleading with us. Because He knows that we have the tendency to choose death. He said, please choose life, that both you and your descendants may live. Your descendants, both you and your descendants may live. Family altar is very important. As families, we must pray together and study the Bible together at home. You're laying a foundation for years to come. Your children may not appreciate it. You know, I remember in our house, when we time to pray in the morning, some say, oh, time is gone, we are running late. They don't want to pray. We still need to pray. Because God is our strength. He's our rock. He's our defense. We can't do anything without Him. So keep doing it. They may not appreciate it, but you're laying a foundation for them for years to come. Years to come, they will remember what mom and dad used to say, what mom and dad used to do. Okay, they will remember those words that you used to share in quiet time. It will never leave them. God said that both you and your descendants may live, that you love the Lord your God, that you obey His voice, that you cling unto Him. He is your life. is the length of your days, and that you will dwell in the land. Amen. May these promises be ours, even as we obey in the name of Jesus. So in conclusion, I want you to think through the choices you're making on a daily basis. From the simplest one to the toughest decision you have to make. Those who believe God, do not make haste. You don't rush to make decisions. You take it to God in prayer. You talk to God about it. You ask for his mind on the matter before you take a step. Think through your choice, weigh your outcome. Think about how it will affect people around you. This morning we read that in Philippians 2, that we should not just look out for our own interests, but we should be on the lookout for the interests of other people. How will your decision affect your family? How will it affect your church? How will it affect people around you? Be patient in decision making. Ensure that it is based on God's word. Let it have a positive and a right influence on all those around you, so that you can leave a good legacy behind. What legacy are you leaving behind? Yesterday we went for a celebration of life, a wake keeping of a lovely woman of God who died, and everybody was saying the same thing about her. How soft-spoken she was, how caring she was, how she opened her house, you know, to many children, how she raised up many children that were not at home. What will be said about me and you when we're gone? The Bible says the memory of the righteous is blessed. What will people remember you for? As somebody who fights, as somebody who does not forgive, as somebody who is sweet? Amen. Amen. What choices are you making? Your choices of today will determine what legacy you leave behind. Shall we pray? I want us to say, Lord, for the wrong choices I have even made in the past, have mercy on me. Forgive me. For choices that I have made out of ignorance, choices I have made in haste, choices I have made without consulting your perspective and your will, Lord, we ask you to have mercy on us. We don't want to be a waste of space. We don't want to live for ourselves. We want to live for you and be a blessing to all those around us. I want us to pray that the will of God, the word of God, will begin to guide our choices in the name of Jesus. Father, that we will begin to involve you in our choice making, in our decision making, in the name of Jesus. Every step that we need to take, that we will involve you. We will ask for your purpose. We will ask for your will in the name of Jesus. Even as Jesus laid down his very life for us, you chose to. Except for the joy that was set before you, you endured the cross. You despised the shame. Lord, we receive that grace to begin to choose right, so that we can live and leave a legacy behind for our children. We give you praise. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed.
Amen.